list your work and start by telling that you already as 17-year-old you moved to Paris to study at Sorbonne, and you also studied at Copenhagen University before entering the Danish National Film School, where you graduated in 84. Yeah. And you started quite successfully in advertisement and TV series, including a TV series called Taxa, which I know some Czech people also have seen. And after that, you made 9 feature films. Your first one is in 90. It was called The Birthday Trip in English, and you premiered in Berlinale. As far as I know, screened in MoMA, so on, and the next film was a children's movie, a Danish children's film called On Your Own, which opened Berlinale Generations in 98. Following this, you teamed up with the Dogme brothers, the four guys behind the Dogme movement, and you made the fifth Dogme film, which we of course would like to hear more about that process also. Italian for Beginners in 2000, which was a major hit in Czech Republic, but also internationally, and outside of Denmark, it was, I think, picked up for distribution in more than 40 countries and screened in many festivals, apart from that as well, of course. And it was really your breakthrough film, and it gave you the chance to work abroad. In 2002, you directed Wilbur Wants to Kill Himself, your first production in the UK, followed by a Danish production, Just Like Home, I think was the title, in 2007, which we'll talk maybe also a little bit about the process of that film, which was quite alternative. And then you moved on to 2009 and Education, which was your 3-time Oscar nominated film, and it won a lot of awards, including the BAFTA. And then you made in 2011, One Day, a US-UK co-production. 2014, Riot Club, again in the UK, with a quite British subject and British historical film. And then now in 2016, you made your 9th feature, Their Finest, which will premiere locally in Karlovy Vary. In a week or so, and then we know that you're working on your next feature film, which you're writing yourself, and I would love to return to that a little bit later in the conversation. So, you also worked as a writer on films you didn't direct yourself. You worked with Andrea Arnold on her debuting film, Red Road, which kind of, I don't know if it started with you, that project, but you can tell a little bit about that later also. You wrote or you adapted the script for Pernille August's latest film, A Serious Game. The writing process is also something we would like to hear about. Roughly, you told me yesterday you would like to talk about these 3 legs in filmmaking, which you can very roughly talk about: the script process, the budgeting and the financing process, and the directorial side of things, which is pretty much the whole creative side of making the movie once the script is there and the money has been found. So sort of like starting from the beginning of your creative process, what kind of like spark do you need to throw yourself into a project? When you look at a script that's lying there in front of you, or you start by writing your own script, what is that first sort of idea or spark you need to feel?
Yeah, it's changed a bit over the years. In the beginning, it felt like I was maybe too focused on just making a film, that in itself was a purpose. And over the years, especially as in Europe now, we are doing many, many films that too few people see, that it becomes more and more important for me that the film itself is about something that I either really want to share or really want to fight for, whereas earlier it was more about whether I felt I could contribute or whether I felt a relation to the film, whether I felt that tonally the script was something that I somehow had a familiar feeling with. And early on, it was more about just getting to do something, for better or for worse, because I was so keen on making films that the Dogme film I did, Italian for Beginners, which was probably the biggest game changer in terms of getting to make all the films I want to. I was so willing to just be the one who made the bad Dogme film. The first four had been really successful. So I just wrote about things that I loved, or things that I had tried, or things that was close to me, all the jobs I'd had as a young student, things that worried me, and there was no control with the script whatsoever. You just got some money and a first shooting day, and somehow that film hit a soft spot with many, many people all over the world, which gave me a lot of trust in the fact that I had a right to be there, I would say. How many are directors in here?
How many work in film? Or would like to?
And how are there any writers? Okay, from writer directors. Okay, it's just yeah. So, but at the moment, I get more critical. I get older, and I think I have more of an obligation to at least try to make films about something that is worth people's time and worth a couple of years of my time where you are away from your family, or long frustrating nights, or all the trouble that you go through, that the films feel that it, or where it feels so meaningful that I think I should do it, because in some sense it is a super selfish project to be a filmmaker, that you do it for your own sake, and because there's something people you really want to show somebody, or there's a joke you want somebody to laugh at, or but I try now to do something that means something. So the next film I will be doing is probably more pretentious than any of the films I've done, more personal. I've written it myself. It's a big theme I finally fight with, which is homelessness in the United States. People who have fallen off the system in America, where you say you're one paycheck away from losing your home, your insurance, your job. And it takes months in America to just be someone who is, from being someone who's part of society to being someone who's on the street. And it's a bold thing for me, because all the other films I've done have more romance or are more modest, and generally I like having humor in the films. I think humor is a way that I can hide a little bit, and not, but it's also a sign that you don't want to be taken 100% seriously. So all the films I have done have a combination of humor and drama in them. But the next one is more sad. And I urge younger filmmakers to try to not have, that the purpose is not to make a film, that the purpose is to make that film, to tell that story. Because that is what also takes you through all the meetings you have, all the financing, all the conversations with the writer, or if you write it with the director or with the actors, that you can keep coming back to, why is it we have to tell this story? What is the core of it? Not a message necessarily, but what is special for this film, and the reason why everybody should spend so much time and resources making it. I think when I look at the films I've done over all these years, I wish I had been better at sometimes not working on the next project, but skipping some of it and try and find out which films do I want to do in 3 years, because it takes so long to get there from the beginning to even the first shooting day, that you're almost a different person, interested in different things when you get to that point. But it helps that the last 10 years I've done the films very quickly back to back, so I dive into something and love being so obsessed with the world that a film will offer, if it's a historic world or a political environment, that I can come into that time machine or move in space and time and live in a certain period for a while, but then not be so obsessed with it that I don't keep taking a step back thinking, okay, why is it we're doing this? And I try to get better at it now. So I am more critical now.
Mm-hmm.
It's not enough that I love it.
And was it a...
And there are things that I love that turns out that you don't love after a while. My sister is a stage director, and she said that sometimes she has... And it happens on the theater that after 2-3 weeks, people find out it's just not as good as it was on first look.
Mm.
And I've experienced that with films too, that I get a little tired of it, that it's just not something that's worth spending all this time on.
What do you do? How do you refresh the process for yourself?
But it's fun to make films, the process, and you go from one journey to the next. So even if your work discipline, my work discipline is pretty good, but even if it's not, it's a moving train, and you will get to that tomorrow you have to do this, in 2 weeks you have to do this, then there's the composer, then there's a music recording, then so the film itself has a organic rhythm, and you just it's your duty to stay interested.
And it's something I also wanted to ask you maybe a little later in the conversation. I have a feeling you involve yourself in all steps of the of the creative process, and production and post-production. Maybe we can take a step back. But when you talk about this sort of like the process leading up to the next film, I mean, was it a hard time after film school to go there and like ponder about your debut feature?
Yeah, I was really young when I got out of film school, and I started working as a script supervisor, and I did a lot of advertising films and edited those and directed them and got a lot of film through I got a lot of experience just from the different technical issues that arise with advertising. But it was good times, the 80s, there was so much money in advertising, and I did usually things people could drink, milk, beer,
lemonade.
I
know, very successful ads in,
and,
in the time. Yeah.
If things weren't, I kept saying to myself that I would learn something, so I took one job after another, just I better do it because I'm going to learn something. But later I think I should maybe have stopped and focused more on my own things. I think it is really hard to combine writing or directing with a different job, but I always have.
Mm-hmm.
And I think people think they can teach for a couple of hours and then go home and write, or have this, which I've done for my whole life, been a scriptwriter off hours, but it really is better if you are young and can afford it to focus on your core job. And advertising ruins your timing. I mean, technically it helps you, but it ruins your comedic timing. But what it did teach me was to tell the story, to remember to communicate, so that when I have to communicate much more complex things, that I get that I don't forget to tell the story. And I see a lot of it. I teach at film schools and I see a lot of first-time filmmakers where they have forgotten to shoot important moments of the scene. Someone forgetting their keys, but then they forgot to shoot the keys that are in at the table while everyone left. It may not be necessary, you can always cut it out, but the simple storytelling, who reacts to what, who sees what, the grammar of filmmaking, I think is something that I did learn over those years, also because I was a script supervisor. So this thing about where to put the camera, how to organize things in shots, or the mise-en-scène, blocking, whatever you call it. I got over that. And a lot of film schools are, it's super expensive to teach it because you need a camera, you need actors, you need a couple of teachers to teach people how to do this. And so a lot of young directors are just not very good at it. Mm-hmm. They don't develop a proper cinematic language of their own because you can't exercise. And when I waited a lot of, I worked in restaurants when I was a young student, and it struck me that after 5 years of being a film director, I had fewer shooting days than I had waiting tables because you shoot so little. So even calling yourself a film director is a big thing.
We actually have some clips we can show you from your work, and we should start with Italian for Beginners. Is it a trailer or is it a clip? Yeah.
This was a Dogme film, so there were 10 Dogme rules. The films had to be handheld. No tripods, no artificial lights, no costume, no makeup, no genre, no dramatic structure. We all had that though. The director is not credited, no guns, and no music. But there's music on the trailer. So many good memories, and these were actors that I had worked with again and again on different films. I had picked them from different projects and I've worked with them many times, but then I wrote with a colleague a film after this that was written for the same cast, but this film became so financially successful that we couldn't get those actors for the next one, so we moved it to Scotland. Which was a shame, and I still see them, and somehow I know they regret they didn't do the next film, but things got, it's this thing about friends and money. I didn't negotiate the deals, and I didn't want to be part of the negotiation. But the producer, they felt that they got too little out of it. Later they did get lots and lots of money over the years because of their copyright they had in the film. So I was asked if I wanted to co-produce with Scotland and take the next film to Scotland. And I went to Scotland with the writer, and I thought it was visually incredibly fascinating for me to be in a world I didn't know. I'd never been, and I think it took about 10 minutes and then I said, yes, we'll move the entire film here. It was, the architecture was much better than what I was used to, shooting in a world that wasn't my own, shooting in language that wasn't my own, also shooting in a society that is much more dramatic than the one I come from. Denmark at that point especially was very egalitarian, and at that time it was the country in the world that had the smallest difference between the richest and the poorest people, which meant that the things in the story where people really worry about their social security worked, was a lot stronger when we moved the film to Scotland because it was a more dramatic society. I also had to not just write to people I knew and who I felt secure around, but suddenly have other actors who I didn't know bring a lot of new elements to the table, and I loved that, and I still really do. I like, it's safe and good to work with people you know, but having someone, a new actor who you haven't met, like unfold their feathers like a peacock and bring a new color into the world you are trying to create, I think is super fascinating. And every time I walk away from a film, I think, I'm never gonna shoot a film without this person again. But it turns out, yes, I will. And every time I fall for them and enjoy the collaboration very much. But Dogme, the quality was so bad because that's what the film looked like. And the budgets were so small that we all had a big explanation problem from then on, because they said, if you can do something that that many people want to see on such a small budget, you can, why do you need more? And the answer was that we all had a classical film background, and you can't, you want to use the full orchestra. And so all of the Dogme brothers, Lars von Trier, Thomas Vinterberg, Søren Krag Jacobsen, not all of them, but some of them went from Dogme back to doing something bigger and more more aesthetic than they had ever done, like as if you'd been on a diet and finally you could go, fine. So then I did Wilbur Wants to Kill Himself, which really is a quite small film that takes place in a bookshop, but we had massive score. I think it was actually recorded here in Prague. There were so many strings and beautiful, beautiful big, big bookshop that we built for this film. And a Scottish cast who I, some of them I did work with again in other films, so I do, I stayed connected. And Wilbur himself, who played that part, I'm also still in touch with. He's a fantastic actor. So
should we see that?
See that?
Let's see that.
Yeah.
A very basic question: how did you deal with the language?
I don't know if I did.
Because it's not even English.
They have that Scottish. They have to speak it. I don't. A lot of directing is about reading the actors, not so much about what you say. But you have to be really precise, because if you say something to an actor which is, you know, two or three words away from the word you should have said, then something in a performance turns up months later where you think, why? What's going on here? And that's because you maybe said dizzy instead of happy, or then you get an actor who... so it's important to say little but be precise. Mm-hmm. I mean, English is a very rich language. They have many more words than we have in Denmark, but I learned that from that film. Conceptually, or if we are going to talk about directorial concepts, Dogme was one very strong concept. It was a set of rules, and you had to sign, I'm going to stick to these rules.
And you had to strip down and cut away.
And make, and but one thing, the best thing that I learned from working with Dogme was to make limitations, to insist in my mind that those limitations or obstacles are gifts. So whenever, if it rains, you have to go out and say, yes, that's so much better for the scene, for this. And that has helped me many times to always try and turn problems into, see if it can make things even more or stronger or more original. And often you're, or if you can find not just a plan B, but a different plan A, then I mean, you have to, because it's it is, film is always the logistics are really tricky. But the concept with Wilbur was visually, we never put the camera anywhere where it wasn't somebody's point of view. We had one shot where the camera was all the characters were asleep, and the camera was tracking from one to the other, and we go, hey, we can't do this because this is, now you feel that there's a cinematographer there. Mm-hmm. And the most films I've made, you never see that someone is telling you the story. Whenever a shot feels contrived, or you can feel, ooh, that's a very nice camera move, then I tend to not do it, because I want the characters and the audience to be together and not feel that there's a director like, am I not clever? We could have this lens. Or so very rarely you see the director in the work I do. We took out a lot of colors, and I've done that later to just remove everything that was bright yellow or bright green. We did that with an education as well, and people say, "Wow, how can you create a London that is so convincing?" And it, old people said it was just like being there, but we actually took a lot out.
Like actual objects or yeah, scaling
like
down?
Get rid of this yellow table because it steals the show. Mm-hmm. Or in a lot of, you very often take out a lot of red because it physically steals the show from the actors. I know Ken Loach does the same thing. But the main concept with this film was that every character, the way they look, whatever they say is based on their opinion on life. Wilbur doesn't want to live. He commits suicide once a week or tries to. So that's his view on life. His brother is deadly ill and is the real suicidal person. And he wants his life more than anything. Then there's this nurse who says Wilbur is so sexy in that red dress. She's the nurse, and her view on life is that she thinks she's God's gift to other people, and that life wouldn't be worth living for nobody if she wasn't in this world. And so it was quite mechanical. I wrote it with somebody else, and because we had such strict rules about every character, then the story did become quite complex later on, because it was super mechanical from the beginning. And I still think it's the best film I've done. There's something about this film, also because it is such a strong cocktail of life and death. It's really about, you know, and the fear of being ill and having to say goodbye to your family. And my own father had died when we shot the ending of Italian for Beginners, and it was kind of a way to get out of this life and death thing. I went to the person at the Danish Film Institute who decides to who should get money to make films, and had a long meeting with her, and she was like, are you sure you should make a film now? Shouldn't you go for a long walk on the beach? And I was like, no, the hell I should. And so I was just driven with telling this story and not resting at all. And I still like that the film is so simple.
Mm-hmm. Was that the simplicity you took from Dogme also, or does it go further back, this being able to see that the limitations?
I think it was part of it was that Dogme was so messy, and the editing, and that was the part of that idea that it was very, very spontaneous, that I wanted to take the spontaneity you had, the thing, the innocence that Dogme had, and the things that only happened once, take that with me, but then do proper classical, well-composed CinemaScope filmmaking. Mm-hmm. And it's a good director of photography. The camera was, and it was the first film I've shot digitally, and the camera had big problems, but each shot is designed. We had lots of resources for that film because we'd done a film that was successful, so it was really easy to finance it, and we could work in a really good temper. I bought this morning a crystal like bohemian crystal Prague souvenir necklace which old ladies wear, because I used to have one. And one day when we were shooting, I was wearing this really, really long necklace and it broke, so there were just beads all over the set. And it took about a minute, and then the crew had picked them up and gave them to me like this. I was so touched, because it was like a spontaneous good reaction from everybody who was just staying there. They could have just gone to lunch and I could have crawled around. So
it leads me to a question, like if you set your own creative team and your team on the production, you're really, you're handpicking? How does it work?
Because then I got so happy with working in England that I bought a cheap plane ticket to London, put my best clothes on and went and rang the doorbell of an agent in London. Mm-hmm. I had had an American agent and I don't belong there, and I don't have the ambition of working in that system, but I liked England and I liked those actors, and I got an agent in London who turned out to be Nick Hornby's agent. So I fought a lot to get to direct an education. That was a script that was in circulation. They call it the blacklist, which is the best scripts that nobody wants that are circulating, and I'm sure that, you know, 20 directors had turned down an education before I read it and said, yes, I'll do this. And I promised myself that Nick Hornby, who is he's written this many books, but it was actually the first original, or it was based on somebody else's story, a woman who had written about her, a chapter of her youth. The only other film script Nick Hornby had written was Fever Pitch, which was based on his own novel. So he was, in a way, a first-time script writer, but a very experienced writer. And I thought, this is like a little egg I have to run a marathon with and make sure that the egg doesn't break when I take his small script through the whole film machine, where you, so much happens and you... until here's a film with people who look different than they had imagined. I remember Nick always said, why are they so beautiful? They don't have to be so beautiful. The next thing you're going to tell me is that you've cast Halle Berry to be the cloakroom girl. but they are very beautiful. And let's see the trailer, because then I can explain the concept. Carey Mulligan, who plays the lead in this film, is incredibly important to the film. Casting is so important, and you can never be too thorough. Now and again, I've cast someone where it wasn't the right person, and it makes a big difference. It can ruin a film. A bad wig can ruin a film too, but casting is worse. But Carey was, she is someone you can tell a story through. You can read, her face is so open and she's so reactive that I think that is one of the things that makes her a leading actress, and as opposed to someone who's just good but can't carry a film.
She was still very young and fresh at the time.
She had hardly done anything, and there were other actresses that I tested for this, but they didn't have this thing I knew was crucial to this story, is that we see things through her eyes. The film is about a man who picks her up with the cello on the street and then shows her London West End in the 60s, where she lives in a suburb a little outside, and is thinks she's going to university, but then she meets this man who she falls for. And that Dogme actually has an influence on this film, even if it's not a Dogme film at all. Now and again, the camera is a little bit, it is handheld, to get this soft, innocent feel that everything is breathing a little bit. And also to get the connection to New Wave, the French Nouvelle Vague, she talks a lot about, I want to go to Paris and I want to see films and I want to be an existentialist and smoke and wear black. And so she has that in her. And the time has that in it, that those are the films she longs for. That is the life she longs for. That doesn't exist yet because this is 1961. So she has all these women that she's surrounded by, her mother, who's always a little bit on drugs, Emma Thompson's headmistress, stays somewhere in their minds that they don't.
So what if you don't get in? What if you don't get in like three times? What do? You want? You know,
we
you
have
want
to excellent make. Directors coming out of Denmark who did the best. People have not been to film school. Mm-hmm. But they're still a little bitter. Yeah, yeah, but I never got in. So there is a certain pride. You also get a generation of people that you know, and if you can stick with them, maybe not necessarily work with them, because it's often better to work with somebody you... I learned that a lot from working in England, because I couldn't bring anybody, that actually it was absolutely fine to work with people who had, who I didn't know, and that you get so much from people you don't know because they inspire you, and sometimes they've made many more films than you. But it's also really good to have someone you can hook up with. In Denmark, it's quite normal that a director and a producer hook up. It's much harder to find a director and writer relationship. If you find one, stay with it. Because the, working a director and writer together is... I mean, some of the best people in the world do. Look at Haneke, Kieslowski, Fellini, Truffaut. They are, it's just, they have connected with writers and worked with them again and again. It is extraordinary.
Was there another question here? Nope. I would like
you
to
show the trailer to their finest before
yeah,
we go.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then so just a few words about your new project also.
Oh yeah. I have done a couple of more films that there hasn't been that much time to talk about, but the new one, this one you should see. This is in Karlovy Vary in a week. It's mm-hmm. called Their Finest in Czech. It's called Their Finest 90 Minutes, whatever that translates as, and yeah, so.